I never saw a great white shark in the wild until I was 22 years old. I mean, for me, it was just like a like the ultimate sea monster, but I wasn't afraid of it. I was fascinated by it.
Okay, here we go.
One of the biggest things I learned, especially when I got my job at National Geographic, there are so many talented, professional, all-around better filmmakers than me. And I wondered, I kept getting all these amazing jobs and these amazing opportunities. And I thought, oh, I certainly can't be that good.
With two Emmys for cinematography and more than 100 film credits, Andy Casagrande is probably best known for his work on Shark Week.
And the reality is, you don't have to be the best. What you have to do is work really hard, be passionate, and be a nice person.
He's filmed in more than 60 countries with the most advanced cameras available.
And I'm heading out right now to see if I can't put a fin cam on the dorsal fin of a great hammerhead. Natural history films really get into the mind of the animal and it inspires people just like it did for me as a kid.
Over the next hour, we'll go behind the scenes of natural history filmmaking.
Watch the tail, watch the tail,
watch your feet on the ground.
And into groundbreaking research on sharks.
Well, that is the perfect shark. He's active, he's hungry, he's into it.
To me, it's like the secret life of sharks, the secret life of predators. And sometimes you really only have one shot of getting the shot.
Isla Guadalupe. 130 miles west of Baja, Mexico. Mm. 22 miles long and 10 miles wide. It's an unforgiving chunk of volcanic rock. It was a green oasis in cold Pacific waters until European whalers left goats here for food in the 1800s. The goats nearly stripped the island clean. Today, seasonal fishermen come here for abalone and lobster. Elephant seals journey here to mate and give birth. And then, there are the sharks. More than 300 great whites gather in these waters in autumn. The most popular theory is that it's a migration layover, as they travel through the Great White Cafe to the west and stop here to mate and feast on the seals and sea lions. Juvenile great whites begin arriving in July. The sharks keep coming and keep getting bigger until the giant females, some 18 feet long, arrive in October. The island and surrounding water is now a protected bioreserve. And may be the best place on the planet to cage dive. To the untrained eye, this may simply look like sharks coming to check out the divers and try to snatch a piece of tuna. Casagrande is here to capture shark behavior with renowned shark researcher, Dr. Mauricio Hoyos, who has been studying sharks for more than 20 years. Scientists have been concerned that baiting sharks might decrease natural predation, condition sharks to artificial feeding, transmit disease to them, and increase accidents between sharks, divers, and cages. Hoyos and his fellow researchers had a question. Can they identify and quantify how using bait to draw the sharks in for photos and close encounters impacts their behavior?
What's up, everybody? I'm Andy Casagrande out here at Guadalupe Island, about to dive with the greatest sharks on Earth.
Casagrande's cinema science mission is to film some of the 11 behaviors identified by researchers and ultimately put a fin cam on a great white to capture them from a shark's point of view.
I'm wiping the bubbles off of the lens, because every single one of those cameras has to be operating, has to get a clear, clean shot. If one battery dies, one card malfunctions, the whole shot is ruined.
Using bait is okay with authorities, but intentionally feeding the sharks is illegal. Hoyos and his team spent 3 seasons on 6 boats, documenting nearly 5,000 shark interactions with the bait. And here's what they found. The third most common behavior is called parading, where the shark slowly swims around the bait, then swims away. The second most common behavior is close inspection, when the shark swims close to the bait, but doesn't open its mouth to take it. The most common, at 30% of documented behaviors, is the horizontal attack, preferred by mature males. The more dramatic vertical attack is preferred by immature females. The study is now a baseline for human-shark interaction at Guadalupe Island and can be replicated at other cage diving hotspots for comparison.
It's recording the camera?
Yeah, this one okay. Is.
If Casagrande is going to put a fin cam on one of these sharks, the bait movement and his timing will need to be perfect.
This thing will run for, I think, 24 hours, but they're not made for going deep, so it's a risk they might just flood. Oh, big male.
Look.
But maybe if we throw it out the back and drag it right along here.
Here we go.
No!
Came up!
Yeah, the GoPro broke off.
No!
Yeah, it's going down.
Oh my God, no!
He ate it!
Yeah.
No, no. Well, if it was easy, everyone would be doing it.
The first rule of shark cinema science is always pack a spare. Second rule, share what you learn.
And I got kids of my own, so I've been teaching them since they were the youngest age, taking them diving with great white sharks, getting shots. So I want to try to break down all the barriers, teach as much as I can. And essentially, if you want to become a wildlife filmmaker, photographer, cinematographer, director, you can do it.
Betting that this shark will circle back around, Casagrande slips out of the cage and prepares to drop down on the great white as it takes another pass.
With shark diving, I'll have a safety diver if I think I need one. With great white sharks, if I'm outside of the cage, I trust my safety diver, but at the same time, I almost pretend like they're not there.
He attaches the camera, and the shark speeds up. Within a few minutes, it spots a sea turtle, a sitting duck for a shark this big in open water. Curiously, the shark actively avoids it at the last second. Perhaps disturbed by the camera on its dorsal fin, it circles around the area and other boats for an hour, never chasing their bait. The camera's timed release pops it off. Ultimately, Casagrande captured all 11 behaviors identified in the study. Next stop, Mossel Bay, South Africa. Named by Dutch sailors for its abundance of shellfish, Mossel Bay has a colorful history written mainly by Europeans, who used the port as a safe haven on trade routes to the east, a source of fresh water, wheat, fish, even ostrich feathers. Today, it's synonymous with cage diving and shark research. Casagrande's focus on this cinema science mission is to gather data on great white behavior and film it.
We're out here in Mossel Bay, South Africa. This is one of the great white sharkiest places on the planet. It's also one of the places where the seal colony is closest in proximity to civilization.
Oh. Got a great white shark right here. It's taking a decoy.
Whoa. Working with Ocean's research team here, the shark took the decoy. We haven't even really got started. But we've got Dr. Enrico Gennari.
Yep.
From Ocean's Research, and what we're trying to do today is put fin cameras on these great white sharks to get a cool perspective of what it's like in their secret world. We can track it underwater. This gives us all the acceleration data, and when it pops off, this floats to the surface, and this VHF tag allows us to track it. I'm a bit nervous here in Mossel Bay because these sharks are really bitey. They're really curious. So when this thing pops up, we're gonna have to retrieve it as quickly as possible or it might get eaten. So now we just gotta bring a shark into the boat. The idea is to get its dorsal fin to pass right by here. Enrico's gonna pull this off, which is gonna make it a bit more dangerous for us, but the accessibility to the shark will be better. We should be able to get it on the fin. These sharks here, they're very active.
Let's do it.
The longest shark migration ever documented started here in Mossel Bay. A great white named Nicole was tracked from South Africa to the west coast of Australia, a 5,500-mile swim. She stayed at the surface more than 60% of the time. Researchers suspect great whites may be using celestial clues for long-distance navigation.
And a big part about natural history, wildlife filmmaking, is knowing when and where to go and being there at the right time.
Yep. Spinning around. Nope, something's about.
You can get off-road permission, nighttime permission. You can get sort of all the permissions you need, but you have to do it respectfully and you got to get the permits to do it. And the cool thing about working for National Geographic, Discovery Channel, BBC, is that they will get the permits. They have the researchers, they have the time, the producers to get the permits, get access to those animals. You don't want to break those rules because if you go to the Serengeti and they see you flying a drone without a permit, they're going to put your name on a blacklist and you're not going to be allowed back in. If you don't have the local knowledge, you're gonna struggle.
Is it coming back?
Yeah, it's turning around towards the bait.
You might get lucky, but in wildlife filmmaking, you wanna give yourself the absolute best advantage of getting the shot.
It's coming in on the bait. Right from your left.
I want to sort of debunk the myth that to be a professional filmmaker, you need the best cameras on earth. You can get some of the most amazing shots. This isn't a commercial, right? Just with a GoPro.
Coming up.
One down deep under the bait. It's not coming, it's coming up slowly. Yeah, this is it.
Some people more toward the right.
Okay, I'm holding it.
On your bait.
How big do you think that shark was?
That was close to 4 meter shark.
4 meter great white shark, probably a female?
Yeah, definitely a female.
It was acting very, very active around the boat. Hopefully it goes out, hunts, or does something very cool. Mating, surfing, feeding, fighting, something cool.
Anything but this.
So we've been trying to deploy this tag, this fin cam, for the past hour and a half, 2 hours. So far, no luck. It's kind of a precarious situation. We got to get the sharks as close as possible, get them to go for the bait. Ideally, their teeth pass, their heads pass, dorsal fin presents. We deploy it on the fin. Sounds easier said than done, and we're going to keep trying.
Coming in from your right hand.
Okay. The team decides to try their luck at the back of the boat, so Casagrande can get closer to the water.
Right in front of you now.
2 meters. Yes, perfect.
This shark is smaller.
So close.
Increasing the risk of the fin cam slipping off again.
I built it in my garage. It's got syntactic foam, a couple of springs. I put a VHF transmitter on there.
Turn again.
When it pops up, it floats to the surface. And it's just like an ice cube.
This is a good shark. Let's try the side here. Anything. Yeah, here we go. Turning. Okay. Grab the legs. It's too far. Bring it in a little.
We always had one shark at a time. It's very weird.
Yeah, that's weird.
Okay, it's on.
Well done.
All right.
Fin cams are super cool because they give you this amazing perspective of actually riding along the dorsal fin of a hammerhead, a great white. The secret life of sharks, the secret life of predators is really fascinating to me.
Great whites tagged off southern Australia allowed researchers to calculate their metabolic rate from their swimming speed and discovered they burn the caloric equivalent of one seal pup every 3 days. But Mossel Bay's great whites aren't hanging out at the fur seal colonies. Dr. Gennari's tracking data paints a different picture of shark behavior. They spend the majority of their time here, on the coastal reef, feeding on fish and smaller sharks. And then there's a second surprise. When they want to conserve energy, the sharks drift in the current here for up to an hour. After about 4 hours, salt water corrodes a small piece of magnesium until it breaks and releases the clamp. The fin cam pops off the shark and floats to the surface.
Yes.
The acceleration, depth, and location data from the sensors on this rig will be added to Dr. Gennari's data. Hansby, 3 hours west of Mossel Bay. It's been a shark cage diving hotspot since the 1980s. Historically, these cold, nutrient-rich waters had plenty of sardines to feed the birds and seals, and plenty of great whites to keep the seal population from eating too many penguins. A healthy ecosystem in balance. In 2016, a couple of orcas moved in and began hunting great whites for their nutritious livers. The sharks dispersed, and the great white population plummeted.
South Africa used to be one of the greatest places on earth to see great white sharks, but because of seasonality, potentially overfishing, killer whales ripping out their livers and eating them alive, there's all types of different elements that go into wildlife filmmaking.
Casagrande's mission is to find a large great white and capture predation from the shark's point of view. The best place to do that is Shark Alley, a world-famous channel between Dyer Island and Geyser Rock, swarming with seals.
Right. Shark's coming around the stern. Coming up. is the perfect shark. He's active, he's hungry, he's into it. So let's try again. All right.
Another large male shark approaches the boat, doubling the chances of getting a camera on a dorsal fin. Apex predator circles the boat and disappears into Shark Alley. Great whites are opportunity feeders. They'll take a meal wherever they can get it. Juvenile sharks are also bottom feeders. They cruise the sea floor looking for rays, reef fish, and anything hiding under the sand. The shark returns to the boat several times, but just isn't interested in the bait. It disappears for good, taking the fin cam with it. Rule number 3 of shark cinema science: write your name and number on your gear. A shark boat full of tourists finds the fin cam. The captain returns it to Casagrande. And when he reviews the footage, he gets what he came for: predation. The shark approaches a cage full of divers and spots a sealed decoy. It circles back around and attempts 2 back-to-back horizontal attacks, first on the fish bait, then on the sealed decoy. Here's the predation again, in slow motion. Mission accomplished. Freeport, the Abacos, Andros, Cat Island, Nassau, the Bahamas. 16 major islands, 100,000 square miles of turquoise water, and sharks, lots of sharks. Just the place for a cinema science mission. Casagrande is headed to Tiger Beach, which really isn't a beach, but a shallow reef and sandbank about an hour from Grand Bahama Island. Discovered in the 1980s, it's arguably the best place in the world to swim with tiger sharks. As Casagrande says, this place is sharky. Caribbean reef sharks, oceanic white tips, lemons, hammerheads. But the tigers won't show up until the water is chummed. He does a quick fin cam test on a lemon shark. It immediately slips off. He makes a quick adjustment to tighten the fin cam's grip. the first tiger sharks begin to arrive, easy to identify with their distinctive stripes. These are macro predators. Females max out at 16.5 feet and 1,400 pounds. Their teeth are unique, serrated like a bread knife, and pointing outwards from the center of the jaw, easily slicing through bones and even turtle shells. A reflective layer of cells behind their retina captures more visible light than the human eye, making them efficient night predators. Predation is exactly what Casagrande hopes to capture.
Wildlife cinematography is so important because it actually teaches us to connect with nature. And like, it's sometimes the closest that any of us will ever get. To me, it's like, I get kind of emotional, right? Because some of these areas that I've gone to for years and years and years, you're starting to see less and less animals, the habitat loss. Everything is so interconnected on the planet. It's important we realize that humans are, we're a super species, we're super smart. We've kind of taken over, but we need to sort of give back a bit. We need to play nice.
Unlike these tiger sharks and the fin cam, its clamp was designed for great white dorsal fins, which are wider and less angular. He tries to tighten the clamp one last time. This time, it holds. Over the course of 2 hours, the shark seems to swim around aimlessly. But when the footage is sped up, it's clear that the shark repeatedly goes from the surface to the bottom and back again. It's called yo-yo diving behavior. At one time, researchers thought it helped the sharks navigate or conserve energy. But when they attached accelerometers to the sharks, they discovered that the sharks were beating their tails consistently, not saving energy. And when they added a camera, like this fin cam, they could see it was hunting behavior when the shark accelerated toward a school of fish on the bottom. As for predation, well, this reef shark takes a page from the great white's playbook. Vertical attack on the fin cam. The Outer Banks of North Carolina, a 200-mile-long string of barrier islands, once the summer fishing grounds for Native Americans. Home to the first English colony. Abundant sea trade brought marauding pirates. Today, it draws anglers and scuba divers from around the world. Casagrande is here to capture newly discovered shark behavior. Lights are critical to filming in the deep. Ocean water filters out colors as you descend. Red is gone at 15 feet, orange at 25, yellow at 35, and so on. Adding lights to the camera housing has changed its weight. Ideally, it will be just a bit positively buoyant so that it's easy to maneuver. And if he has to let it go, it goes to the surface instead of the bottom.
I don't often like using lights. I know Hollywood shooters love lights. And if you think about it, photography, what it means is photography. Photo like a photon, like a beam of light. Graphy like calligraphy. Photography, photography is writing with light.
Merciless storms, war, and shifting sands have sunk more than 3,000 ships in these waters, known as the graveyard of the Atlantic. This is the USS Aeolus, a 438-foot-long World War II troop carrier, later converted to lay cable and do surveys. After 6 months of cleaning and preparation, She was towed out here and sunk in 1988, joining more than two dozen others to create an artificial reef. The ship was fully intact until Hurricane Fran tore it apart in 1996. 4,000 tons of wartime steel have become a thriving ecosystem, with skipjacks, barracuda, schools of scad, and these, sand tiger sharks. They're also called gray nurse sharks, maxing out a little over 10 feet and 350 pounds. Globally, reefs are in crisis. Overfishing, pollution, warming waters, and increased acidity have killed half of the planet's coral reefs since the 1950s. Artificial reefs are becoming ever more important, providing shelter and spawning grounds for small fish, food for larger fish, and layovers for migratory species. These giant wrecks can be especially productive, and the taller, the better. Structures that rise 30 feet into the water column can support, which is to say feed, 11 times more predators than a natural reef. The sand tigers seem to love it here. They are distant cousins of the tiger shark and are found worldwide in temperate coastal waters. Don't be fooled by their fearsome teeth. They are all but harmless to humans, unless provoked, which is why Casagrande won't be putting a fin cam on one. Touch a sand tiger, and their bite reflex will ruin your day. Overfishing and bycatch have nearly crashed the population by 75% in the last 30 years. Unlike most fish, sharks don't have an air bladder to keep them buoyant, but they do have giant livers, comprising 25 to 35% of their body mass. The liver is packed with oil, which is lighter than water, helping keep them from sinking or from spending too much energy. Sand sharks have another trick up their sleeve, one that no other shark is known to have. They can gulp air at the surface and hold it in their stomach, making them more buoyant, like the camera housing that won't sink. As the sun begins to set, a change in behavior is triggered on the reef. It's a phenomenon documented by researchers studying footage captured with ROVs around six wrecks in these waters. As the daylight fades, the scad instinctively know the skipjacks will begin hunting them. This is what Casagrande has come to film. The scad begin leaving their hiding places inside the wrecks and gather around the sharks, enlisting them as giant razor-toothed bodyguards. The hungry skipjacks wouldn't dare plunge into these swirling bait balls. Curiously, these sharks are nearly all females, and they have been documented returning to the same wrecks year after year. Studies have shown that sand tigers can impact the types of species found at wrecks. When they are absent, more bottom-dwelling species like grouper and sea bass are found. About an hour after sunset, the sharks will leave the wrecks and begin their own hunt for dinner. 137 volcanic islands settled 1,000 years ago by Polynesians. Known for a rich culture, beaches, and biodiversity. Hawaii. Final stop on the Tiger Shark Cinema Science Tour, the North Shore of Oahu, well known for its tiger sharks. You've heard of shark-infested waters. Well, now you know what it looks like. These are mostly sandbar sharks. Unless they mistake Casagrande for an octopus or reef fish, he'll be just fine.
I've gone on a few jobs recently. I'm like, oh, where's the best sailfish action or marlin, or where are the humpbacks running right now? You start looking on Instagram or any sort of social media platform, you're gonna find hashtags where it say hashtag killer whale, hashtag polar bear, and you could reach out to these people. I post often about my adventures and use hashtags as well. So hashtags are a really good way to kind of get quick and dirty, so to speak, research on where the animals are and what they're doing.
Tiger sharks are macro predators, commonly found around Central Pacific Islands. The females are larger, maxing out at 17 feet and nearly 2,000 pounds. Their distinctive stripes fade with age. This is Roxy. Her mangled mouth makes it hard to catch prey, so she's figured out that if she bumps the humans enough, they'll buy her off with a chunk of fish. Roxy was likely caught by commercial fishermen who pulled her in with a hydraulic winch and bounced her up and down until the hook was torn out. Shark attacks in Hawaii are rare. Since 1928, there have been 116 confirmed attacks and 8 deaths. Researchers wondered why more shark bites have been documented around Maui than here in Oahu, when Oahu has 6 times more people. Roxy helped figure that out. She and 95 other sharks were tagged by famed shark scientist Dr. Carl Meyer and his team, tracking them for 6 years. The goal was to assess shark bite risks at popular swimming and surfing sites. Here's where Roxy swam over the course of 16 months. The data showed that tiger sharks routinely visited popular Maui beaches more than 10 times often than similar spots in Oahu. The difference? Topography. Maui's insular shelf, an area from shoreline to about 600 feet deep, is rich with food. It supports resident sharks and attracts sharks from other islands. Researchers were careful to note that attacks are rare in areas where sharks are often near humans, indicating these apex predators are actively avoiding us. Bimini, legendary hideaway of Hemingway, giant blue marlins, and turquoise water. Casagrande is here for the hammerheads.
So we're here in the Bahamas. It's the best place on the planet to dive with the great hammerhead sharks. And I'm heading out right now to see if I can't put a fin cam on the dorsal fin of a great hammerhead. It's gonna be awesome. All right, so we're already at the site. It's only 5 minutes offshore, only about 300 yards offshore, 20 feet deep, amazing conditions, crystal clear water. We should get lots of sharks, so we're gonna get started. Chuck the anchor. So the hammerheads feed on all kinds of things, from stingrays to other sharks, but they can't resist fish. So here for bait, we got a couple of ladyfish, and we got a special bait, which is a barracuda that we just caught this morning. A couple of sharks are already milling around. Can't quite tell if there's any hammerheads down there yet, but this spot is notorious for the great hammerhead. It's the coolest shark in this area. Give this a shot. Usually I'm diving in really cold water with super dangerous sharks like great whites, but here it's like a dream. Bahamas is amazing because miles offshore from the United States, super close. The people are awesome on this island.
It's never that easy. Time to break out the chum. Nurse sharks and remoras usually show up first. They grab whatever scraps they can before the big sharks arrive. When they don't get a treat, they can be pushy but are harmless. Of the 9 species of hammerhead shark, the great hammerhead is the largest, averaging 13 feet long and 500 pounds. Females are generally larger, the biggest ever recorded reaching 20 feet in length. Their head extensions are called cephalofoils, giving them a few advantages. Researchers believe widely spaced eyes and nostrils help pinpoint prey. These sharks can use their heads as weapons to knock stingrays to the bottom and pin them to the sand, biting out a chunk of fin. They bite a chunk out of the other fin and circle, waiting for the incapacitated stingray to die. These are apex predators, but attacks on humans are extremely rare. Putting a fin cam on one is tricky business. Timing is everything. He lures them in with chunks of fish. This looks dramatic, but is in no way harmful to the shark. A great hammerhead this big could easily injure Casagrande if it felt threatened.
But I gotta say, those sharks are amped up. There's at least a half dozen nurse sharks down there, and they want the bait just as bad as the great hammerhead, but the hammerhead rules this roost. It came in beautifully, got the fin cam on. Woo! That was crazy.
This cinema science mission isn't complete until the camera is retrieved.
Well, I deployed my fin cam about 4 hours ago on a great hammerhead. And ideally it should be popping off right around now. I flipped on my receiver and so far, it's been pretty quiet, which is a little unsettling because ideally it would have popped off by now. But then again, those GTRs, it's a galvanic time release. It's a slow saltwater dissolve. It's not a perfect science. Sometimes if the water's different salinity, different temperature, different depth, it can take different times to dissolve. So I still have a lot of faith that I'm gonna get it back.
The antenna is highly directional and can detect the fin cam's VHF signal from up to 75 miles away. But that's line of sight. If there are waves or an island in the way, the distance can go to near zero in an instant. Casagrande circles the area, checks the harbor, but still no sign of the fin cam.
All right.
At this point, the shark could be halfway to Cuba. He breaks out the drone for a visual search. Still, nothing.
Let's check one more time. Whoa!
Oh, no.
I thought for a second I heard it. As soon as I fired it up, I heard a bit of a squelch, but it's nothing.
I've been drifting at sea here in the darkness now for almost 5 hours. The gauges on this thing don't even tell me how much gas I have, so honestly, I can't tell whether I'm running out of gas, I've got enough gas, I've got an oil light going off here. I'm gonna check on the receiver one last time. Listen for the ping. If it's not there, I think it's pretty much time to call it quits, go back, and just try in the morning. Nothing.
4th rule of shark cinema science, when in doubt, consult the boss. Casagrande teams up with his wife, Emma, a safety diver and experienced camera operator. They join several divers who already have great hammerheads swirling about them. He adjusts the camera angle based on the size of the shark to get the ideal framing. The shark circles and comes back a few times, allowing Casagrande to fine-tune the camera position. Hammerheads love to scan the bottom and find stingrays hidden under the sand. That's what they're hoping to capture. They play around for an hour, and the hammerhead returns. They have no intention of losing this fin cam. They captured more than they could have hoped. Initially, the shark takes off at a high rate of speed. After a few minutes, it tries to knock the camera off, as if it's a parasite. They get no predation, but in this 1 hour of footage, they capture 400 million years of evolution. The shark rolls to the left and swims for a minute. It rolls to the right and swims for a minute. The hammerhead repeats this over and over again. Some of this very footage was used by a team of scientists studying hydrodynamic adaptations in hammerheads. According to their research, tagged wild sharks spend 90% of their time swimming at angles between 50 degrees and 90 degrees. It works like this. Swimming in a vertical position, the shark relies on the width of its pectoral fins to generate lift. It's impossible to generate more, unless they swim at an angle, using their massive dorsal fin to increase their width relative to the sea floor. By doing this, researchers calculate that a hammerhead expends 10% less energy to swim the same distance. Screen grabs from Casagrande's fin cam footage are embedded in the published study.
Leopard seals. I really want to go to Antarctica and film leopard seals. You guys hear that? Nat Geo, anyone watching Discovery, BBC? Give me a call. I'm ready to go.
I'm ready.
Got it.